Welcome, everyone, to the Health In Show, an affiliate program of Homeopathy World Community. We're going to be visiting with Jayney Goddard, the president of the Complementary Medical Society Association, and we also have our regular co-host, Dr. Deepak Sharma, with us today. And we're going to be waiting on her to come into the program as she has appointments. In the meantime, I would like to welcome all of our listeners and our viewers. Thank you so, so much for sharing this show on Twitter, on Facebook, wherever you are, in your emails. Welcome, Dr. Deepak Sharma.
Thank you. Thank you, Debbie. And welcome to all the listeners and viewers of our show. And we are just we are just waiting for the Jayney, and we are waiting very impatiently
right.
when she is coming.
I would like to ask you, have you had a mind body experience for yourself?
Yes, many times. When I am studying in the graduation. And I feel very less in the concentration power, weak memory. Then I tried many type of homeopathic medicine also. But there was a spirit inside me that boosts me. And I did the meditation at that time, and it will help. So if your mind, if your spirit is okay, and his spirit is high, then you can treat yourself with the cancers also. So you need a high spirit always.
The spirit that you found through meditation.
Yes, definitely, by the meditation.
And if anyone is out there listening and watching, you can call in to 919-518-9773 if you're in the United States. If you're outside the United States, you can call to Computers 2K Voice and call in. We'll pick up your call. We'd love to hear your story to find out how you experience mind, body, and spirit meditation or medicine, whichever it was for you that made you realize that you are a totality, a whole person. Not just because of how you brush your teeth and take care of your body or get up and go to work or study your lessons at school, but how your thinking and your personal awareness of yourself in relation to other people and your environment. I wanted to mention a couple of items, a couple of news items. One is that there's going to be a 8th Annual Joint American Homeopathic Conference for 2013 in Reston, Virginia. It's called Meeting the Challenge, if you can see that. And that is going to be April 19th through 21st, 2013 in Reston, Virginia. If you need further information, you can go to homeopathic.org, which is the website for the National Center for Homeopathy. I went last year. It was phenomenal. It's going to be great one more time. Every year it's going to be great. They have a lineup of all of these fabulous speakers. Ann Jerome, Shashindra Joshi, MD, Frederick Shoyens, George Dimitriadis, Jerry Cantor, Will Taylor is going to be there, Kim Aaliyah, Bishwashi Joshi, Karen Allen, Henny Hooden's Mast, and many other people will be there to meet up and discuss the latest cutting-edge homeopathy.
What is the web link for this program?
The web link will be homeopathic.org, or you can look up on the National Center for Homeopathy in your search engine. Okay, and I wanted to mention now what we consider mind-body medicine. It focuses on the interactions among the brain, the mind, the body, and behavior, and on the powerful ways in which emotional, mental, social, spiritual, and behavioral factors can directly affect our health. It regards as fundamental an approach that respects and enhances each person's capacity for self-knowledge and self-care, and it emphasizes techniques that are grounded in this approach, which means that people in all fields of health and medicine well-being have their kind of their niche, whether you're doing Reiki or music therapy or art therapy. There are so many different ways to approach getting in touch with self. So do you have a comment, Dr. Sharma?
Yes. Basically, when we are studying about the homeopathy, this is also a part of complementary medicine, and it acts on all the system of the body. Like, we started from the mind, we are taking the physical journals, we are taking the whole totality of the symptoms. So we also consider about the mental symptoms also, how the patient is feeling irritable, how the fear the patient is having, and how much the phobia, and what kind of phobia a patient is having. So there are all the medication of homeopathy is concerned about the mental symptoms, and it must be needed for every physician. And I also seen in some of practice who are doing the yoga and acupressure and acupuncture, they are also taking the mental symptoms first. Many of the allopathic physicians may also be asked about the mental symptom. How is your irritability? Because every medicine knows that our mental symptoms cause the physical journals. Like when a person is having a more irritability, more violent in nature, has always have a gastric symptoms. Like constipation, like irregular bowel movements. So we need to consider about the mental symptoms in every medicine.
Okay. Yes. Well, that is a wonderful introduction. And I just want to give you a little formal introduction, because Jayney will be getting on the line with us in a minute or so. And so we can start with our PowerPoint, which will give you a beautiful, I mean, I could probably talk for 20 minutes about her. Mind, Body, Spirit, Jayney Goddard, and she is the president of the Complementary Medical Association. You can find her at jayneygoddard.org. And the next slide says, I wanted to introduce a quote, "In the midst of difficulty lies opportunity," said by Albert Einstein. And this means the way that we approach and look at adversity will determine the opportunity that we take and the outcome that we will receive when we enter that narrow path, those restrictions or constrictions or whatever it is that's troubling us in our life. Will we look at it as a test? Will we look at it as something that we can overcome, that we have the inner strength, whether it's courage or whatever you think is your weakness, what it is that you can reach in deeply and overcome in order to traverse that path. And now we're going to go to the next slide, which is Complementary Medical Association, which is, Jayney is the president, delivering excellence in complementary medicine. It's the world's largest professional membership body for complementary medicine, and Jayney is widely regarded as one of the leading experts on complementary medicine and natural health. She has gained so many awards and honors. I'm not going to list them all. She has been elected a fellow of the Royal Society of Medicine, recently awarded the Complementary and Natural Healthcare Expo Award for outstanding contribution to complementary medicine, which was judged by the panel of respected complementary medical professionals and a group of high-profile captains of industry coming from backgrounds as diverse as banking, insurance, and entertainment. So you see that everyone out there, whatever your career path is, has some thing to do with your mental, body, and spiritual health. If you are having trouble with your finances, you're being challenged in that area. Jayney is also a fellow of the Royal Society for Public Health. In diversity in medicine, in the next slide, Jayney has a busy practice in London where she works using a range of complementary medical approaches, including homeopathy, including psychotherapy and hypnoanalysis. She is the editor of the Complementary Medical Association journal called With Our Compliments. She is a high-profile contributor to all kinds of print and broadcast media, an expert for various newspapers and magazines, a regular guest on television and radio. So you should be familiar with seeing her face if you're in Europe. She's been on the Discovery Channel's Complementary Medicine and provided all kinds of complementary medical content for Granada Boots PLC joint venture called the Well-Being Channel. In her publications, we're on to the next slide. And next, her publications, she has written a highly acclaimed book called The Survivor's Guide to Bird Flu, The Complementary Medical Approach. And we know annually that the flu is on everyone's mind, and we want to take personal control of our health and not be told what to do and forced what to do in terms of vaccines and whatnot. We're almost ready to she has a really long intro today. I'm going to go to the next slide. She is an advocacy. She is doing advocacy for complementary medicine, alternative medicine. Jayney recently testified for the United States of America's White House Commission on Alternative and Complementary Medicine in order to help the USA rationalize complementary and alternative medicine, and all her recommendations were accepted unanimously. I don't think anybody in America will agree to anything, but if you did that, you are superior. In the UK, Jayney is a member of the Parliamentary Group of Complementary and Integrated Medicine, and she is active globally, assisting governments worldwide to rationalize their approach to ethical, that's a big word in my vocabulary, responsible complementary medicine. And I'm going to just go ahead to the next slide. She's a great speaker, and I'm going to clap and just get her onto the show here. Can you hear me?
Welcome.
Yeah. I can hear you. Can you hear me is more the point after all the strange things I've had happening today.
Yes. You want to tell us your story of how you got here today?
Debbie, I got stuck on a train. Can you imagine my panic when I knew that we had this lovely interview all scheduled up, and there I was helpless on a train. So I just went into a very, very, I thought, come on, you know, take a piece of your own medicine here, Goddard. And, you know, as I went into this beautiful, deep, heart-centered meditation, you know, pulled all my resources together and actually, you know, eventually got here, and here we are, and it's all absolutely over. Okay, so, you know, this stuff works.
Whatever is meant to be. I know I had a lot of intro to do and call to action and ask people to go to the joint American Homeopathic Conference, which is going to be in April. It's going to be a big deal, and we want people to show up to that. And I know you put on tons of conferences. So yes. I'm just going to sit back and hear you tell us about revolutionary mind, body, spirit.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Well, thanks, Debbie. And you know, really, I just want to say thank you so, so much for having me back again. It's always a delight. And what I noticed actually is that you've got such a vibrant group of people who tune in. And so I'm hoping that we're going to get some really cool questions during the show. But also, I just wanted to say that lots of people contacted me after the show.
Could we lose
natural, natural anti-aging. So yeah, you know, I just wanted to say, let's open the doors to questions. Yeah, what is mind-body medicine? As Dr. Sharma was touching on earlier, mind-body medicine is the idea of, I suppose, ultimate holism. How do we integrate absolutely everything? And it's a recognition within conventional medicine because of the wealth of conventional research supporting it nowadays, that we are not this disparate mind and separate body, but in actual fact, there is, this unity of mind, body, and dare I say, even spirit. They're even coming to recognize that. Now, of course, in complementary medicine and natural health care, we've known that for, well, since the year dot, haven't we? So, you know, it's not such a struggle for us. But it's always quite nice, I think, to actually see the research catching up eventually. So what is mind-body medicine? It's an acknowledgement that there are certain steps that we can take and certain things that we can learn to do to elicit something that Dr. Herbert Benson, who I've had the immense privilege of working with in the last year or so at Harvard Medical School on his training, which is the revolutionary practice of mind-body medicine and clinical training in mind-body medicine. So Dr. Herbert Benson, as I'm sure everybody listening knows, really is the granddaddy of mind-body medicine. And his fabulous book, The Relaxation Response, and various other writings and so on, are the ultimate tomes in this field. What Herbert Benson does is he teaches other teachers, practitioners, doctors, and so on, and his team actually teach the ways of eliciting the relaxation response, ways of teaching this approach to our patients and to ourselves, most importantly as well, in order to achieve changes in pathology and changes in allostasis, which is almost an interchangeable term with homeostasis, although allostasis implies a set of ongoing syndromes that actually help us adaptively to maintain a healthy balance. So what happens when we elicit the relaxation response? Well, various things. You have better and more recuperative sleep. You can actually develop a better physiological status. So certain cytokines are modulated so that we're less susceptible to inflammation. Of course, you know my feeling about inflammation in that it underlines most of the chronic, avoidable actually, and treatable chronic diseases that many of us will degenerate into unless we actually do something about it and really take care of our health and well-being mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. Mind-body medicine also incorporates things like exercise and physical activity, nutrition and supplements, healing beliefs and positive emotions. So it really is extremely holistic. So where does homeopathy come into that? Obviously, myself as a dyed-in-the-wool committed homeopath, which is an homeopathy, of course, and psychoanalysis being my first loves, homeopathy comes into this very, very well because, of course, as homeopaths, mind-body medicine is actually what we do. Anytime we're case-taking, we are constantly looking at everything from this most beautiful holistic perspective. I'm sure that we'd all agree with that. We are looking at, as the unprejudiced observer, at what it is that makes this patient unique. We're actually really taking into consideration everything, mind, body, the physiology, the history, the spirit, absolutely everything. And so actually, homeopathy and mind-body medicine are incredibly closely aligned in very, very many ways. So if anybody has any questions about that, that would be fantastic. So what is the science behind mind-body medicine? Well, it's actually really interesting. There's an awful lot of supporting science now. What we look at particularly at the Benson Henry Institute for Mind-Body Medicine at Harvard Medical School and also at Dr. Benson's clinics and so on, is that we look at allostasis and allostatic load. We look at how the brain's mediation of the stress system can work towards homeostasis. We also consider very carefully a scientific review of mind-body interactions. We look at basic science and clinical research on lifestyle behaviors and how that affects health and well-being. we look at the relaxation response in the role of the relaxation response in support of allostasis, and we also look at the metabolic consequences of psychological stress, which I'm sure all of us would realize that, you know, psychological stress has massive impact on the physical body. So that's really where we're going. So any questions? That was a long introduction. I shall stop speaking now, Debbie, and say, is there anything you'd like to know?
That was a wonderful introduction. While you were doing that, I was posting on the chat a link to Dr. Benson and the Mass General Hospital and his clinics. People can see there all about his work. In the chat, Kavitha Kukunur of Michigan asks, are there any specific centers of mind, body, spirit? And if yes, where are they concentrated?
Well, that's a fantastic question, actually. The answer is there is a distinct lack of them, actually, around the world. Yeah, absolutely. This is why I actually went over to Harvard myself, because I just felt, well, you know, I looked and looked. And I couldn't find anywhere to actually take this work further. And I wanted to really dig into it with much more depth, because my background therapeutically is obviously my first love, homeopathy. What I needed to do, though, this is my own personal journey therapeutically, is that I came out of the amazing, incredible training that I did at London College of Classical Homeopathy, which is a very, very long course. And I found that I was being a brilliant case taker, even if I do so say so myself, but my poor patients were probably exhausted after about 3 hours of case taking. I was very thorough.
3 hours? I'm with you. I understand what you're doing.
And I was, you know what I'm saying. So, you know, you graduate and you want to be perfect. There you go. That says everything you need to know about my pathology. Yes. But anyway, you know, you want to be perfect. And I was really trying to be the perfect homeopath and get every single tiny, eensy, weensy little symptom and then add them together and spend a further 10 hours analyzing the case. Well, obviously, in the real world, that doesn't work, does it? And I bet I can probably imagine there's a lot of homeopaths out there chuckling away going, oh, yeah, that was me as well. Anyway, so what happened was I ended up realizing very quickly that this was not acceptable and I was exhausting my poor patients and so on. So I had to find a way of actually taking a better case and to actually cut to the chase. What was the real information? How could I drill down and kind of find my way through the noise to actually get to the salient symptoms, to really drill down to what that case was truly about? So I ended up taking myself off on an odyssey of learning about Ericksonian hypnoanalysis and psychoanalysis, and then getting into the world of Rogerian person-centered work and bolting all those beautiful psychotherapeutic approaches onto my practice of homeopathy. For me, it worked. I really enjoy working in that way. And I find that I actually get more information, more salient information from the clients and that observational process. So anyway, that's kind of how I ended up becoming fascinated with this whole mind-body approach. And to go back to answer the question, where in the world can one do this? Well, I had to take myself off to Harvard. I'm actually setting up a training which is going to be web-based. So actually trying to facilitate as many people as possible who want to actually embark on this beautiful healing odyssey with me. It will be using many of the principles from the training at Harvard Medical School. And I've spoken to them about this. And, you know, it looks as though it's actually all, yeah, it's all really, really good. So if anybody's interested, just ping me a message and I'll keep you posted and let you know when we're going to kick off with that, because I think it's something that is absolutely revolutionary and does transform practice.
Fantastic. How's your audio doing, Jayney?
It's cutting in and out a little bit, but I can hear you perfectly. I don't know how you're getting me.
You're excellent.
Oh, good.
Okay. No double or reverberation or echo or anything.
No, I'm good this end. I can hear you perfectly, Debbie.
Okay, wonderful. Maybe I should just ask, you just came from a conference. What is it that you took? It sounds like, like myself, you want to get every little detail. You spend 3 hours on an interview, and you want to be sure that you're getting it right because somebody's life is in your hands, and you want to be perfect. So now, hopefully, we've realized life is a journey, and everybody's on it, and we take it as it comes, and we don't have to be quite so perfect. We might strive to be the best that we can.
Yes.
And it sounds like you're using your hypnoanalysis in the case-taking process. Is that correct?
Actually, Debbie, that's completely correct. And I'd be really interested to hear if there's anybody else out there who is a homeopath working psychoanalytically as well. Because what I find, speaking for myself, is that the borders have actually become very, very blurred. And I will often – I actually had a PhD student interview me for part of the work that they – the research that they were doing. They said to me, so what do you actually do with patients? And I had to step back and think about it and think, well, gosh, that's a really interesting question because, wow, you know, the borderlines now for me are very, very blurred. And actually, for me, it's become this gestalt, this entire sort of holistic approach. And so what I find now, and I think this happens as we become experienced in our fields. Of course, now I'm a much faster case taker, thank goodness, which is a blessing and a relief for my patients. But what's actually happened is that I will often find that I'm thinking, psychotherapeutically, I may be using processes, even hypnoanalytic processes during the case taking. If something comes up that triggers a need to do that in me, this is a very subconscious response. It's not something I set out to do consciously, but it is something I find that actually works stunningly well. And I find that homeopathy for me has become so, so much bigger than what, you know, just what I was trained with over the 4 or 5 years that I trained. And I'm certain that other homeopaths will echo that. It just is this growing, extremely seductive thing that you just go into deeper and deeper and have this lifelong love affair with and passion for. And so that's kind of where I am now, Debbie. And so I'm thrilled with the whole mind-body side of things because that speaks to me.
Right. I think
I'm coming from.
I think that maybe, no, I want to give Dr. Deepak Sharma a chance to speak also, but I mean, you've really touched upon something that is happening in the world of homeopathy, the sensation method being one of those things where the person appears to go into a trance state, a state of consciousness that obviously if you were looking at their brain waves would be different than their daily waking hours. Another Dr. Dinesh Schwan does case witnessing. And this means that one is the observer and the witness of the person who is explaining their state of being in this world. And it sounds very much like hypnosis or an altered state of being. But it's also the two people. And that's why maybe you love it so much, because you're gaining and getting so much enrichment as being that witness, as being the person who is like a guide or enabling the person to get into the place to understand what is happening to them. That's a disorder or a filter in their life that they're not able to move forward, whether it's they're stuck or they're afraid of something, whatever their challenges.
Exactly, Debbie. Yes, you're so right. Isn't this what we do as homeopaths? We hold the space. We hold the space for people to be able to take time to analyze, truly think very deeply about where they are, what their health conditions, emotional situation is, their life condition, their maintaining causes, and so on and so on and so on. Because of the questioning that we use as homeopaths, yes, you're absolutely right. It does elicit an altered state. Now, any kind of hypnosis can be considered to be an altered state. So, yeah, Debbie, you've really hit the nail on the head there. Absolutely. Yes, we do elicit these altered states, and which is a tremendous thing, because it allows people, you see, most people, as we know as homeopaths, most people have ever been in a safe enough space to actually be able to speak about the gestalt of what is going on with them. And so we hold that space, we honor the person's process. And I think this is something that very often in homeopathy is actually sometimes forgotten about to a certain extent, because very often I speak to homeopaths who are so busy chasing the remedy and looking for the remedy picture and looking for the patterns and so on and so forth, which is absolutely essential as homeopaths, of course. And I'm not throwing the baby out with the bathwater by any means, but the power of the, and the, what I mean is the therapeutic power of the case-taking process itself must never be undermined. And I'm sure that many other homeopaths will agree with me when they say they've seen extraordinary change happen within clients and patients just after the case-taking process, before they've even given the remedy. So it's a beautiful way of opening up and beginning the unpeeling process, I suppose, with pathology and with people's stuckness and state. What do you think, Debbie? Is that something that would echo your experience?
Yes, I actually tell the client who I'm working with, number one, tell them it's a partnership. And I depend on them as much as they might want to contact me. And that this is the talking itself. It's talk therapy in a way. The talking itself is they're opening up to their own inner awareness. And at some point they have an aha moment.
Yes.
And that is the beginning, because everything in life in our material action-oriented world starts through thought, meditation, like Dr. Sharma started at the beginning. It's just the idea, the inkling of the idea that comes in, the awareness of it, and then the talking. We have to speak out loud and put that voice into space, into time. Mm-hmm. And then from there, we can actually say, okay, I'm ready to go on that diet. I'm ready to go out and take my walk today. I'm ready to do whatever it is, because we've mentally prepared ourselves.
Yes. Yes, absolutely, so, Debbie. I couldn't agree more. Dr. Sharma, what's your experience with all of that?
Yes, I will tell you my experience, but I want to ask you one more thing, Jayney. Are you treating the children?
Yes, I am.
So I have a question. If a six-year-old child is coming to you and her parents are asking that he is having a constipation for 2 years, a severe constipation for 2 years, and how you will proceed the case by the hypnosis or by the chronic case taking? How will you proceed this type
question.
Of cases in
okay.
the children?
Did you say 6-year-old or 16-year-old?
Six.
Yes. Right. Okay. That's a really great question. Actually, the way that I would approach this would be to do a conventional case taking homeopathically. However, there is this mind body link, and a lot of research currently points to the idea of this gut brain axis. And in fact, constipation has been shown to be one of the conditions conditions that actually worsens from thinking about it. There has actually been some, now don't quote me, I have no idea where I read that, but I do remember reading it in a journal, and I will attempt to find the reference. I can't promise you, but I have a funny feeling in the back of my mind, and I suspect it's probably in one of the mind-body journals. But anyway, so yeah, I would probably approach this. I would probably approach it cognitively by doing a conventional homeopathic case taking. But I suspect that I may well integrate a mind-body approach. I would probably integrate probably a standard hypnotic induction. And the beauty of hypnoanalysis is the idea that it's an analytical process that is facilitated by inducing an altered state of awareness, if you like, a very, very deeply relaxed state in which more processing can occur, and in which people have many more resources and can actually understand their mind-body issues more deeply. And you can do this brilliantly with children. Children are very, very literal, actually, and that you can get a fantastic case from children, as we know as homeopaths, if you treat kids. What do you think, Dr. Sharma?
Yes, definitely. I had an experience with one child. She was a female of about 6 years, and she had a constipation of for more than 2 years. And I just asked in the details. The history was that the parents are not the cooperative to the child. The right. Parents are always fighting in front of the children. The children is having a fear, always fear that they will beat her. So yes. That was the case, and it was interesting. And I used the medicine of only the Nux Vomica in the homeopathy just to reduce the anxiety and irritability of the child, and yes. The medicine worked. But the main thing is that if we are not doing the counseling to the parents, the condition will be the remain same. So yeah. We need to counseling the parents also, not to the child.
Mm-hmm. You're absolutely right,
perfect
because
counseling
you've got
to... for the parents.
Yes, because otherwise the maintaining cause is still just there, isn't it? And you're absolutely right. And I think this is what is so fantastic about homeopathy, is that we are looking really at such a big picture. You know, we're not just looking at the person, but we're looking at their surroundings, their relationships and their history and so on. It is such a huge field, you know, and I think this is part and parcel of the beauty of what we do. It's part and parcel, I think, of why we can become so passionate about it.
And you have so many tools at your disposal. I know that some people use sand therapy for children. It's a beautiful way to let them be free and relaxed and just play. And then they open up and they talk this way and create their own imaginary world, if you wish. So there and music therapy and dance and movement, all sorts of things that let people express themselves. We have a question. Dr. Wakwar of Florida asks, Jayney, can you please give a practical example of integrating homeopathy with hypnosis? I'm not sure if he's asking to talk about a case or how he's talking about this.
Can I give you a spooky example?
I love it. Anything exciting.
Oh, yeah. Okay. No, this is really, actually, absolutely amazing. I had a patient coming to me for some time. Actually, she was doing very, very well. And it was this, it was a very, very complex case. But overall, everything was all going in the right direction. I always used to give her the option of, look, do you want to see me today with my homeopathy hat on, or do you want to see me with my hypnoanalysis or mind-body medicine hat on? Which would you prefer? And she came in one day, and was really interesting because she said, no, I want to do the mind-body stuff. She said, I love that guided imagery that you do. Part and parcel of the work I do is something called Grovian metaphor work, which was developed by an amazing guy called David Grove. It involves the use of clean language. And what it does is it enables a safe exploration of the purse of the patient's psychological inner world, their ecology, if you will. And it enables them to elicit imagery and to be able to explore that completely safely because we're using clean language, which means that there is no danger of the practitioner's stuff, if you like, contaminating any of that, because essentially we're playing back the patient's words to them. That's it in a nutshell. Go and take a look at clean language and David Grove, because it is the most fascinating thing. So I thought, well, let's do a beautiful guided imagery journey with no input from me. We just essentially, the client goes where she will go in an altered state, very, very deeply relaxed state, and it's very visualization orientated. And the funny thing was that when she came in, and I had suspected for quite a while as the case was opening up that we would see a sepia picture at one stage. Anyway, but so we went on this journey and it was all being led by the client, no input from me whatsoever. We ended up on this incredible journey. And it's interesting because the words and pictures that the client elicits are an extraordinary representation of the physical, the mental, emotional, physical state, even of pathology. But you can actually also then elicit imagery that can be very healing as well. So what happened was that we ended up under the sea.
Oh, really?
Oh, swimming around. Yes, it was absolutely beautiful. We were under the sea, swimming around. And then at one point, the discussion turned to her, her imagery coming out was about her feeling vulnerable, having to put a brave face on things, but sometimes just needing to hide. And then what came out when you say, my response was, and at those times when you feel that you need to hide, which is replaying her exact words to her in precisely the way that she had said them, I said, and what can happen next? And she said, I can see a squid over there and it's swimming past and I can call it over and I can get it to squirt some of its ink so that I can hide behind that. Oh. And can you believe it? And so I'd seen this, absolutely exact sepia picture walking into the room, and without any prompting or guidance from me, the patient elicited through this mind-body work a sepia remedy for her situation. And it did sort the case out.
Well, this is very much this like the sensation method. And
yes,
the person was speaking of the emotional qualities that they were experiencing, but also it was,
yes,
they were the one being attacked. Rather, I mean, they saw the squid as the other entity.
Protective.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, yes, it was a protective. The squid was protective because it had a mechanism within it that was going to be able to shield her and give her the space and time that she needed to actually recoup, regenerate, and heal.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, I know.
And so after this experience, what kind of reaction did the patient have at that point? Because it's really looking at your fears.
Yes, exactly. It was interesting, actually, because it had this whole mind-body spirit kind of effect. And what I noticed was a lot of the physical pathology was so she had a lot of the very sort of very archetypal sepia types, you know, sort of gynae type symptoms and endometriosis, that sort of thing. So a lot that all resolved. So all the physical resolved, the mental, emotional resolved. She came to a realization that she didn't want to be in London anymore, and she then moved back to her homeland in Sicily, and you know, and it all just actually, and she stays in touch this very, very day, and everything has changed. So it was this most extraordinary curative aha moment, you know, And it's extraordinary. But I see this time and time again. And as I say, this is not, none of this journeying is coming from me at all. This is using absolutely clean language, using the Grovian metaphor framework, but facilitating an exploration of the client's or the patient's internal world and their internal representation of their own pathology and what can happen to actually address that, support that, and heal it.
Dr. Sharma, have you ever had such an experience, like similar but probably a different remedy or a different type of situation?
Yes, many, many, many. I have many experience with these type of homeopathic remedies, and recently I have experience with the medicine Dalkamara.
Oh.
That is a new medicine, very rarely used in the spinal pain. But when I taken a case, the patient is having a severe history of spinal injury by in a road accident, and the sensations are very tingling in the both extremities. But the weather was the humid weather when he had a accident. So when I repertorized the case, the whole case, and the medicine was Dalkamara, and it did wonders. I never expected with the Dalkamara for this type of tingling that will cure, that cures the tingling sensation. So we need to expertise in the whole case, not on the single symptom or not on the single disease.
Yes.
We need to summarize the whole case by from top to the bottom. So we need everything.
We have a caller.
That's why Jayney have a Jayney is taking the 3 hours case. That is too good. Too good.
Thank you, Dr. Sharma. That's funny. Yeah. No, I love your case. Yeah. I think that's amazing. Yes, I would never think Dalkamara, but as you say, when we take a case really deeply, the most amazing things come up, don't they?
Yeah. Right. We have to be totally unprejudiced in order to recognize what's being spoken. So we do have a caller. Hello.
Hi, Debbie. This is Kavita. Hi, Jayney. Hi, Dr. Sharma.
Hi.
Hello. Kavitaji.
Yeah, it was very nice discussion and I'm happy to call in.
Kavita, you're going to tell us a story?
I don't think now we have that much time, but let me tell you that, yes, as Jayney was saying that going into that deeper, and even I use the sensation method, so I really see the effects of it, and it's really nice. For one of my case where the boy was talking about all the epi symptoms, and he did receive epis, and so his complaints and his mental and physical, emotional, all the areas have been affected. So there are lot many cases, and I do agree with Jayney's discussion. It was very nice.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome. Thank you very much for your kind words. I really appreciate it.
And nature must be mother. I don't think it's moth. Mm-hmm. On the chat, wants to know if that sepia client was ever given the remedy or just the talk therapy, what the hypno altered state was enough.
Right. Oh, great question. Thank you. I should have said, in actual fact, I did what we do really, really well as homeopaths, and I waited.
So, right.
Obviously. To be honest, I never actually... I never felt that there was a need to give the remedy as a homeopathic remedy, because actually the pathology had resolved to such a dramatic extent that I guess by that time I looked at it and the case had changed it, and everything was so good. I thought, you know what, hands off. I'm not even going to mess up. You know, I'm not going to mess with this. This is looking so, so good. Let's just wait and see what happens. And actually what happened was that the patient was facilitated, because of the response that she'd had to this session, in making such dramatic changes that she actually inadvertently removed the maintaining symptoms, i.e. living in London, being stressed, you know, all of those things that do us no good whatsoever, and actually moving away, moving to a totally different lifestyle, and so on. So actually, as I say, she stays in touch. She now has babies, and she was told she would never conceive. You know, it really is, everything changed. So it was never necessary to actually prescribe, to actually give her, you know, the actual remedy per se.
So basically what happens when the person awakens to this, whatever's blocking them, they shift and go into a new place and are enabled to take the action steps that they need to correct their environment, whether it's toxins or whatever it is. So that's really great to hear. I have a different kind of a question. Mm-hmm. And that has to do with, we're in the middle of a underground covert war of skeptics who are not with the program. I mean, you're going to Harvard and learning about mind, body, spirit medicine and revolutionary gestalt. Mm. And here we have an entire, I don't know what you want to call them, a group of people who are really not believing any of it. And they would say, and this is where I'm going to come from this question, that for the CBA case, you did talk therapy. And they are saying and acknowledging, which is a good step forward, that yes, a homeopath heals through their talk therapy, through the amount of 3-hour case, through the amount of time and compassion and safe space that they provide for the patient to come in and tell their story. So the question then is, does homeopathy work or is it just the talk therapy?
Okay. You know, you mentioned some real hot button statements there that really, really get me going, Debbie. And thank you. What a brilliant, brilliant question. Okay. First of all, you know, it's interesting, isn't it, that these skeptics say they don't believe in homeopathy. Actually, you don't have to believe in homeopathy because it works whether you believe in it or not. Now, we all know that. This is one of the reasons why I very controversially, consistently post animal studies and in vitro studies on my Facebook page, on my Twitter, on my website, and so on and so forth, because on the Complementary Medical Association website. And we've got a brand new website up. If you guys haven't seen that yet, it is mind-blowing. So it gathers together all of the latest research across the field of complementary medicine, not just homeopathy, but we do put a lot of research into researching homeopathy, a lot of resource into researching homeopathy. So here's the thing. I am very cognizant of the arguments, obviously, and especially as I seem to be public enemy number one in the minds of the skeptics. I lose track of the death threats and the terrible, terrible toxic email. Is to realize that all we can do is to send them some love and hope, and send them some understanding or some intention that they will begin to actually be open-minded enough to actually become scientists and to actually be open-minded enough to actually think about, well, what's happening in the field of nanomedicine, what's actually happening in why do these in vitro studies of homeopathic medicines that are diluted beyond Avogadro's number, how come those actually change the expression of DNA, the way that cell lines act, and so on. So this is what I do. Now, as I say, I know I'm being controversial with this because I do mention and I do talk about animal studies. And as a committed vegan, in fact, I'm a raw food vegan. I'm really, really vegan. As a committed vegan, that's a difficult position for me because, you know, I am absolutely committed to leading a compassionate lifestyle. So, yeah, I have issues with that. But I also have issues with the fact that unless we actually do something to really demonstrate that homeopathy is not just all mumbo jumbo and that you have to believe in it to work and it's all actually just placebo. Unless we actually do something that demonstrates that this works not just in humans who can be psychoanalyzed and tricked or fooled into a belief that this stuff works, we've got to protect our profession, because our profession makes a massive difference globally to health and well-being for millions and tens of millions of people, hundreds of millions of people around the world. So we've got to keep this information out there. We've got to keep demonstrating that this is not simply placebo. There is something going on a nanomedicine level that works. And it works if you're a brilliant case taker. It works if you are prescribing a remedy blind to somebody who has some pathology that you haven't spent ages taking a case with, when you're absolutely clear about that case. So yeah, my position on this is just keep the science going out there. There's brilliant research being done in China. Luc Montagnier's gone over to China, as you all know. Amazing research just come out of Brazil. There's a super piece of research on thymoline at 5C being prescribed in a rat poor cellular granulation study. And read the comments on that study. I've put it up on my blog and my Facebook and my Twitter. Read the comments at the end, because they do actually gather together lots and lots of other studies as well. So I think it behoves all of us as homeopaths to actually keep getting the science out there, so that ultimately the skeptics are going to be left without a leg to stand on, and they will have no option, if they are scientifically orientated, to question what the heck is going on in homeopathy, because something's happening.
I think it's going to take that tipping point, because I've heard reports showing that when you are faced with a truth and a fact that is opposed to your belief system, then you actually fortify your belief system even more.
Yes.
So it's going to take a massive effort of community to make that jump.
Well, you know what, Debbie, you're absolutely right. If if anybody sort of thinks back to their philosophy of science, the structure of scientific revolutions, Kuhn, where he speaks about paradigm shift. I mean, it's a really bloody battle. It's like, it really is. What we're looking at is out with the old guard and in with the new. And when these people realize that their status, their belief system is being challenged, they will fight tooth and nail to maintain their entrenched position. If you ask them to step back and look at it logically, as scientists, they would actually say, well, here, actually, you have to question this stuff. But the problem is, yes, this challenge is there, and it is disturbing the status quo without a shadow of a doubt. We are seeing paradigm shift at the moment. It's a hackneyed term, but I'm going back to using it in the way Kuhn used it. The SSR is truly one of the most important philosophy of science. In fact, one of the most important science books written in the 20th century. So I think we should all go back to look at it, because it helps us understand why these bloody struggles are actually really taking place right now.
I know that Amnon has something to contribute to the conversation.
Yeah, I'm not the homeopath. But I use the stuff because it was obviously demonstrated to me, and when I tried it, it works.
Yeah.
But you know what? my philosophy is, if you don't think that it works, but you believe that when you take it, you believe that it may work because of your belief, and it does work, what's the harm?
Good point.
And I'm wondering about those skeptics. If Debbie came to me today and told me, Amnon, go outside to the car, take the garden hose and fill your gas tank, and then take 200 cc of arnica and put it in there, and the car will run. And if I knew that if I believe in it, it'll work, wouldn't I try it?
You might.
You know, and if people saw other people filling up their gas tank and putting a little BB thing in there and it runs, they will become believers.
Well, don't put the water in the gas tank, please.
No, don't do that. This was just like an analogy. You know, if I knew that putting water in there and believing that it'll work, it would work, then after that, it's easy to... I mean, a lot of people want to take... I have a headache, so I'll take an Advil, and within half an hour or whatever, it'll fix it. That doesn't happen like that with a lot of homeopathic. So it's those people may want it to happen right there and then, and it's not going to work, and they don't give the opportunity for homeopathy to get into their life. They're the losers, in my opinion.
Do you want to answer the prompt that Amnon just gave us about the myth that homeopathy doesn't work quickly?
Oh, yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Amnon, fantastic comments. Thank you so, so much. And thanks for listening in. It's really appreciated. And it's so nice, actually, to hear from people who aren't homeopaths. But, you know, and I love what you're saying. You know, you're not a homeopath. You know, you use it because it works. In actual fact, you know, we see that in Germany, that the I think it was something like 95% of all of the football teams in the first division in Germany, their team doctors are using homeopathy. What's the reason for that? Well, it's not because they're a bunch of hippies and they're going, oh, yeah, my footballers are really going to believe in this. And, oh, yeah, it's going to heal them, man. What's actually happening is that these guys have got these incredibly expensive footballers there. And truth be told, they've got to keep those guys playing. They've got to keep them on the pitch. So to be honest with you, homeopathy, when you're and you are a good prescriber.
Repeat that one more time, please. Homeopathy when you're what?
When you're working with acute conditions.
Okay.
And you need your remedy to work really quickly.
Yes.
If you're a really good, accurate prescriber, then you can find that the remedies work virtually instantaneously. I've seen that time and time and time again. I mean, I'd give you another football example, actually. My husband used to, he plays for a veterans team in London. Now, this is a team of South London geezers. These are guys who are, shall we put it politely, a little bit they're old enough to know better, shall we say. And that's being really, really nice about it. Or maybe we should say they're sometimes a little bit past their prime, so they pick up a lot of injuries.
Quit while you're ahead. He may be listening.
I think he probably is, but hey, never mind. You know, what's actually happened is that these guys, these are guys who like to go down the pub. You know, they're all kind of, they love their pizzas and their burgers. You know, these are not guys who are into health and well-being, and they're certainly not hippies in any stretch of the imagination. But the point is that they've seen how my husband can come home. He can come off the pitch limping because he's been kicked or he's pulled a hamstring, and you know, normally an injury where that would put you out for 6 weeks, if not longer, or put you out for the rest of the season. I'll give him a remedy, and there he is, right as rain, the next week again, and playing even better than he was before. So all these guys were saying, so what are these silly little white tablets you keep taking? And, you know, the guys now are homeopathy. You know, these guys are coming up to me saying, hey, Jayney, did you know that you can take such and such a remedy for such and such? I thought, my goodness, I've created a monster. I've got a whole group of stuff.
I have a monster a monster sitting next to me.
She created one because I'll have friends that have problems that I know the kid that has the prize, and I'll give it to them, and then she'll yell at me.
Yeah, exactly. It's really, really fun to see this. But yeah, you know, people, as I say, Amon, going back to your question, you know, homeopathy doesn't work quickly. Actually, yes, it can, especially, you know, when you've got the acute conditions. I would say when you're treating chronic conditions, those are conditions of long standing, you may find that actually you need to go in because the case is developed, it's more complex, it's taken time to develop. You may find that it takes a little bit more time to actually unravel, although actually, conversely, sometimes I've been able to take a case well enough to actually hit the nail on the head first time, and you know, case resolved. And I've seen that sort of thing happen with things like eczema. I've seen it with asthma and so on, which are chronic conditions. But sometimes you can just get it right, and it does actually resolve very, very quickly. So, you know, I'd say swings and roundabouts on that one. But it's a brilliant question. Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
Pleasure.
Yes, you know, I have a comment for this topic. In a common discussion, one of the allopathic physician is just asked about me and told that you are treating by the psychology. And then I answered that the psychiatrists are more than you have a more psychiatrists. You have an allopathic psychiatrist, you have a specialized psychiatrist, and you just send a patient first to the psychiatrist and then to the me, and you will see the difference.
Right, comparing an allopathic psychiatrist who is just going to probably give a suppressive drug,
yes,
and then yes, to and, you.
And for the common person, if anyone is coming to my clinic and just told us how the tiny pills are treated and how they will get the cure for me, so I will told that you just take a sulfur 30 one dose every night and you will tell me after a month.
Oh my goodness.
Oh dear. That's not quite the right approach, is it?
Is that what you would say to a skeptic? Is that what you're saying?
Yes. Yes, okay. They are skeptics and they are always defaming us. So I just suggest you just take a sulfur 30 one dose at night and you will see, you will tell the things after a month.
And they come in itching.
They have a fear. They never did it because they have a fear that homeopathy can work, because they have a fear how a doctor is saying that you just take a sulfur at night and you just take it and this will aggravate 100%. I am very confident.
Well, Dr. Sharma, what about the people who are staging the demonstrations, and they take a bottle of homeopathic sleeping pills, which are probably a combination remedy, and they they eat the whole bottle. Jayney, Dr. Sharma, what do you say to the folks who are doing that, and they say nothing happens to them when they do that?
But they are.
Amnon says it's safe.
They are saying. they are saying that they are not feeling in the few minutes or in a 1 hour or 2 hours. They are having a difference after a long time. The single dose is working, may work in after a month. So if they are taking a whole bottle into the mouth, it may be work after a month or after a long time. The whole constitution may change if they are taking a wrong remedy.
Very interesting. Even if they're eating mints and drinking alcohol, going to the pub and doing other things. Okay.
Yes, definitely. Definitely. Medicine is definitely working.
Okay. Can I come in on that actually and tell you a little bit about what's happened over here? First of all, we send these people some love because they are misguided. And the problem is that they misunderstand. They haven't really taken the time to really understand the mechanism, if you like, or the theory behind the way that homeopathy works. If they were to do that, they'd actually design slightly better studies to disprove what we do. It's a publicity stunt. Okay, that's all it is. End of story. It's us standing outside the big pharmacy in the UK, taking these things and saying, "Oh no, it doesn't work. This pharmacy needs to stop stocking these products." That's what the publicity stunt was all about. Problem is, the actual publicity stunt really backfired on them, and a lot of the papers actually covered it and said, "What a bunch of weirdos. What a strange thing to do. Why would you waste your time doing that?" So actually, they did end up looking a bit silly. And you've noticed they haven't been doing that recently. It's a bit of a sad one. But as I say, all we can do is, just be kind about it, send them some love, send them some healing, because hopefully that will enable them to actually see that, there is something here, and something that if they open their minds, if they are actually coming at this from a properly and a carefully considered scientific perspective, they've got to acknowledge that something weird is happening. Let's look into it.
Amnon, did you have a question?
No, I just said
I just said nobody ever followed these people, and you don't know that an hour after they demonstrated that they're not laying down on the floor somewhere, throwing up or doing, you know, who knows what, they, you know, they may be sleeping for a week. I don't know, but nobody ever followed it. It's easy to say. I mean, I can take a bottle of the strongest drug here and just gollop it down and then go away. Did anybody figure out I actually died 3 hours later? No, they just well, talked about the demonstration.
We would have heard about that. Oh, Anton, we don't want that to happen. No, you're lovely.
Yeah. As a matter of fact.
They have a frustration.
What, Dr. Sharma?
They have frustrations only.
Yeah, and I have written numerous blogs about misguided people who would think that they could commit suicide or do an overdose with a homeopathic remedy, and that's absolutely not the case. It cannot possibly happen. If they have chosen the proper energetic remedy, it may shift them into a new place and they might have a healing crisis. But, you know, if you're not going to be harmed in that kind of a way. There was another question I forgot. What
does the medicine, I didn't read, does it take it out of children?
I think it says on each bottle something about if you're pregnant, you know.
No warnings like regular.
I think there are, certainly in the UK, there are, because I think there have to be some regulatory standard comments, you know. So, in fact, I'm just looking to see if I've got a standard bottle near me. Yeah, there are some standard sort of regulatory comments, which are there more because they sort of have to be legally rather than because they actually reflect any realistic truth about homeopathic remedies.
Right. So typically each bottle of a remedy you find, it's going to have the name of a disease label on it, even though it can do.
No, it does here. It won't in the UK.
It does. It will on our labels. It will say for insomnia.
Yeah. In England, you're not allowed to.
Oh, okay.
EU law. I mean, there are some combination remedies, I believe now that may have an indication. But the thing is, in EU law, you have to be very, very careful about not making any claims, and unless something has a drug license. And some remedies do, and some don't. So it's a little bit, you know, bit nebulous. But what we would prefer to see anyway in the UK is, you know, we like remedies to be available, but what we don't hold with is the idea that patients can go into a pharmacy and simply flick through a very, very basic little chart that says, endometriosis, take belladonna, or night sweats, take this, or, you know, whatever. And, you know, so where they're actually naming in these little booklets chronic diseases,
yes,
and then suggesting you take a particular remedy, because obviously that's highly likely not to work, and people are going to wander away with the idea that homeopathy, yeah, tried it, it's rubbish. You know, so we're trying to educate over here very, very clearly that people need to see a professional practitioner. You know, this is part and parcel of my mission, because I've got lots and lots of different health columns in different magazines and on different websites and so on and so forth. And my constant thing that I'm constantly going on about is see a qualified practitioner, and here's how you find them. Because I think that's, you know, ultimately we've got to educate people to this is what you have to do in order for homeopathy to stand a chance of working.
I agree with you 100%, but I also believe, and this is my vision for the future, that beginning in elementary school and beginning in elementary school and throughout our children's education, they will be learning about homeopathic remedies and how to self-administer on an emergency basis. If they have a cut, a scrape, a bruise, a loss, a grief, I mean, the vocabulary will become ubiquitous. The vocabulary, yes, everybody will know. Oh, yeah, I mean, already people do know arnica. They may not know hypericum or aconite. But the terminologies, he's raising, Amnon's raising his hand. He knows.
Really?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes. And I believe that the more we talk about it, the more the public will learn about it. And he is nodding his head saying, Debbie, did you talk about flu today? So, you know, this has been marvelous. And I really, I could talk to you even more about things like, I wanted to, if I have an extra minute, to talk about one point that you made about the follow-up, Amnon, that nobody follows up. But a homeopath is helping the person through this healing journey. That means there must be follow-up.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I was talking about nobody's following those demonstrators who take a whole bottle and take it in and say, see, nothing happened.
Exactly.
Nobody ever followed up on them to see what happened to them. I'm not saying, oh, I know. I mean, I know how you follow up. You're so religious about it.
Well, what
yeah,
what
I think they're all still alive.
The point that I'm making is the homeopath is helping the person through a homeopathic process. And I call homeopathy a verb. I don't call it the pill. The little pellet or whatever is not anything. And it's how it is utilized. It's the action. It's the dynamism of the relationship of the remedy to the individual and their disease, to the homeopath and how well they get along with the patient. So that's my 2 cents worth there.
Completely agree, Debbie. It's a beautiful unfolding, isn't it? And aren't we privileged to be able to witness that?
It is a privilege. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. I couldn't agree with you more.
I have a question, Jenny, just a little one. Do you know how many complementary system of medicine exists in the world? And did you rate?
Wow, what a question. Well, all I can say is within the Complementary Medical Association, because we're a multidisciplinary group, we're a non-profit organization, and we're active all over the world. So all I can tell you is that we currently recognize about 128 different forms of complementary medical discipline. So now that sounds like an awful lot. But when you think about, for example, if you take massage, then you think, well, okay, under massage, if you use that as an umbrella term, you've got things like Swedish massage, Thai massage, deep tissue massage, remedial massage, and so on. So it actually works out that there are, of course, you know, the big five, the nutrition, the homeopathy, the acupuncture, Ayurveda, traditional Chinese medicine, and so on. But underneath all of those, and the psychotherapies and whatnot, there are all these other types of approach, you know. So as I say, we actually recognize at last count about 128 different distinct complementary medical disciplines. And our criteria for recognizing a discipline is that it has evidence of efficacy. Now, whether that's through trials or whether it's through strong anecdotal data or through empirical outcome studies, that's absolutely fine. But we've got to have some sort of evidence that, that it actually works in order for us to actually recognize it.
Okay.
Oh, that is great. So at any time, you just rate which system is on the top, or is there any ranking? Did you have
ranking of what's used most, like yoga
ranking of the system? Ranking of the system, which complementary system is on the top? You may start for the, as a voting on your website. This is a suggestion.
Okay. Well, is there any ranking? No, there isn't. I mean, because the thing is, there are so many criteria that you could actually use, you know, sort of in a hierarchy, couldn't you? So, you know, is it most effective for this or is it most effective for that? You know, is it popular? What's the most popular? What do people really enjoy the most? What are people we think is really effective but are a bit scared of, like acupuncture needles? You know, so you could actually use so many different criteria, couldn't you? So no, there is no ranking at all. So yeah, wouldn't it be nice? But you know, that it would be such a complex issue to actually create a hierarchy or a ranking, I think.
Of the hierarchy, as you say, would be based upon certain criteria. And so maybe certain cultures or countries would have a preference of what they like to use based on their history.
Yeah, you know? Absolutely. Yes, it's a very cultural thing, isn't it, actually? You know, it's really interesting. I remember when I was in India some years ago, I'd just graduated from my homeopathy training. And so people said to me in India, you know, Indian people said to me, so what do you do? And I said, well, I'm a homeopath. Woo! You know, I was so excited, you know, because I'd just graduated. I was all fluffy and happy and shiny. And I was really amazed that people go, yeah, right. You're 10 a penny. So it wasn't impressive at all for people in India, because you've got so many brilliant homeopaths in India that, you know, I wasn't anything special. So there you are.
Well, so, you right. Are it's something cultural. Special. You are no, something special. And actually, we want to let everybody know that everybody out there is special in their yes. own unique way. And that's what we want to connect with, their inner self, their spirit and soul, and recognize that we can bring out their happiness, you know, their joy in life. And there was actually something, I don't know if I can find it, but there was something going on Twitter today. Let me see if I can find it for you. It was, you know, there's trending topics. It's already gone. They go so quickly. There's... If there's one is you're more attractive if
oh yeah
that I don't know who makes them up, but there are some, and I think there was one today, if I can find it. It was it is you're more attractive if, and I did tweet it. I said, if you just wear a smile.
Yes. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, more attractive to yourself as well, because, hey, you know, that smile tricks your neurology into believing that you're happy, you're getting on well, your day's good, and so on, you know. So as soon as you actually move your neurological status to actually start producing all those luscious, delicious neurotransmitters to actually believe that that is your state, that's what will happen. And then by the magic of magnetism and transference, you'll actually find your day starts going better, because people go, ooh, aren't you a nice person to be around, and start smiling back at you. Hooray!
That's right, because we're mirrors of each other. We're a reflection, mm-hmm. really, of our own images. And, you know, if somebody, you know, it's true. If somebody does something like I do this, and then somebody's going to repeat doing it like I do it, just because it's that energy that's coming through. So, I mean, I'm smiling, I'm not smiling. Everybody out there, you're just filled with joy from this kind of energy. And we want to create those waves of awareness. Everybody's going to, you know, we've been on the show for a little bit of extra time. I have some closing remarks, and I'd like to enable, you know, everybody to have something that they want as a takeaway message, or something that's really... You know, you say, blow your mind. What do you want to tell us, Jayney?
Oh, blow your mind. Okay, well, I would just, if there's anything to take away from this discussion, I'd say we are so much more than our physiology, any limitations that we might believe we have. We are these incredible, magnificent human beings, and really embrace your uniqueness, embrace your magnificence, because, you know, you truly are divine. And so take that away, do with it as you will, keep smiling, keep eating your vegetables, and I just send
spinach.
You all my love.
Amnon says spinach, and
I just want to, you know, I just want to send everybody my loves, and just to say thank you so much for coming along and sharing this time, because it, you know, I've enjoyed this immensely. I've enjoyed feeling all that energy. I feel so empowered now. I feel so happy about being given the opportunity to speak with everybody, and so I just want to say thank you so much, and express my intense gratitude. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. Dr. Sharma, thank you so much. What would you like to say to blow our mind today? Yeah. He's going to laugh.
We all the viewers are missing the Jenny's long hairs to see the long hairs. Like. Everyone
next
is missing.
Next time, Dr. Sharma.
So we will invite you back.
Thank you.
Yes, I was going to say Rapunzel will be with you next time.
Okay, we're
for those,
going.
For those yes, of you who don't know, I have excessively long hair.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Okay, so now we're going to do a few closing remarks. This has been the show, Health In, Mind, Body, Spirit, the Complementary Medical Association. You can look that up on Google. I've put the post up there, and I'll put the link on Homeopathy World Community so you can visit that website, which is chock full of tons of resource material and information and little videos of Jayney talking to us. On the next slide, I have quotes. In every community, there is work to be done. In every nation, there are wounds to heal. In every heart, there is the power to do it. This is a quote from Marianne Williamson, an incredible, inspirational, and motivational author and speaker. The next slide is a call to action to those folks who are on Homeopathy World Community or elsewhere. There's a question on an MSN money. You get that money website, and it says, why spend 4 million pounds of our taxes on homeopathy? Should the UK spend the money on remedies that have no proven benefits to society? Well, think again, because I will tell you something about these polls. The way that polls and questionnaires are written determine the outcome of those results. And you can read how negative this poll is worded. It already instills and implants an idea into your brain and your thought pattern without giving you an unbiased way to make a response. Okay, the next slide is on the Health In Show 2013. We're going to have Stephen Blake. I keep wanting to say horse whisperer, but he's an animal whisperer. He's a DVM, a doctor of veterinary medicine, Stephen Blake. He's going to teach us how to keep my pet healthy. On February 11th, Marcus Hines, incredible gentleman, his daughter, after a vaccination, came down with diabetes type 1, and he's done the research to show us the link between vaccines and this disease. March 4th, Senya. She will be on talking about astrology and homeopathy. I guess that's part of the mind-body medicine. And on March 11th, Dr. Badani is talking about understanding childhood depression, and he is also a psychologist. That is his forte, is children and psychology. Then we have on the tackling obesity epidemic, this is one of my missions also. Stress and obesity is at the heart of many of our pathological diseases today. And there is a new program. I'm giving you the opportunity to, Werner Berger is giving us the opportunity to call him at this number, 215-642-0083 in the United States. He is the oldest gentleman. Last year at age 75, he climbed and summited Mount Everest. He has climbed all the peaks in the world, the tallest 7 peaks in the world, and he says going to do it again. I don't know how he's going to do it, but he does not take any drugs to get this happen. He believes in the power of self. So you can give him a call, because our mission here is reducing obesity. On Homeopathy World Community Blog Talk Radio, Wednesday morning at 10:30 a.m. Eastern Time, USA, Dr. Adil Chimthalawala-Kasim talks about, I wrote health. It's supposed to be heart health. He's a cardiologist, and if you want to hear the guru, that's it. On Thursday at 12 noon, Alan Phillips, attorney at law in North Carolina, talks about vaccinations and your rights in America. Boy, this is also a controversial issue, and he is on the cutting edge of health freedom. So lastly, I'm going to thank you, Jayney, once again. Amnon, you're a doll. My co-host, Dr. Deepak Sharma of the Orbitz Clinics, all of our viewers and members of HWC, Werner Berger for taking calls. Connect with us on homeopathyworldcommunity.com, on Facebook, and on Twitter. So sending waves of awareness. Bye-bye.
Absolutely. Bye-bye, Debbie. Bye-bye. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you, Jayney.
Talk to you soon. Bye-bye, Dr. Sharma. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
You are tuned to the Nissan Communications Network. Our weekly lineup of call-in programs includes Computers 2K Now with Amnon Nissan, Sundays 9 a.m. till noon, Carrie's Psychic Cafe with Carrie Silkowski, Sundays 8 till 9 p.m., Health In with Debby Bruck, Mondays 11 a.m. till noon, Breaking Free with Marilyn Shannon, Mondays 8 till 9 p.m., Reawaken Your Brilliance with Julie Seibert, Wednesdays 9 till 10 p.m. And if you tuned in too late, you can always watch each program in its entirety or download an MP3 audio file of it at nissancommunications.com. Sponsored by thatvidblasterguy.com, carolinaapparel.com, and deltaforce.net.